The effects in 2010, the year we make contact, were designed to be detailed, realistic, and meticulously precise. Special effects artists had to completely recreate the discovery, the spaceship abandoned near Jupiter at the end of 2001.
Records of the Discovery miniature from 2001 were all destroyed after the completion of that film production. Mr. Kubrick was concerned about the Discovery appearing in later science fiction films, so he had the models destroyed, all the plans and drawings were destroyed. We contacted the production designer for the film, and he told us this, and we have located some still photographs from illustrators and people that were connected with the film, but our main source of information is a print of 2001 itself. It's not a situation where one person gets to put this model on his bench and build it from start to finish. It's more like we have specialists in engineering and mechanics to build the basic armature frame for the ship. We have specialists in electronics to build power boxes to drive all the lighting circuits for it, all the miniature lights that we put into the ship. We have some people that are excellent at model detailing that will spend their best hours working on applying the final finish detail to the ship once it's assembled.
The model of the Russian ship, the Leolov, that is sent out to find the derelict Discovery is every bit as detailed as the Discovery itself. 2010 special effects, from models to walks in space, needed to be as realistic as possible, however expensive they turned out to be. People know what real astronauts in real outer space look like, and they demand authenticity. So the movements would be very slow and graceful. The lighting was to be harsh, as from a single source, the sun. Exactly as it would be on a real expedition to Jupiter. At this point of the story, the American team is about to leave the Russian ship and cross over to the Discovery for the first time.
Dear Caroline, the first part of this journey is coming to an end. We are about to rendezvous with the Discovery. The race will be on now. We're going to send a boarding party over to climb inside this 800-foot-long shipwreck floating over Io to see if she can be rescued before her orbit gives up. There are 9 years of secrets inside, including a sleeping computer who knows the answers. My past is also inside, and I want those answers.
Temperature's good.
Yeah. You know, I hate heights.
So do I.
You picked good jobs.
Filming the astronauts' journey over to the Discovery presented a unique challenge to special effects artists at MGM. How to achieve the convincing illusion of weightlessness. The difficulty was how to get the floating movements of the actors that the storyboard called for. For some scenes, they could use puppets or models and intercut them with shots of the astronauts' faces. But for the close-ups, the weightlessness had to be real, or at least it had to appear to be real. To hire a NASA spaceship and crew would have cost $75 million. MGM settled for a somewhat less expensive solution, special effects. They brought in a wire flying expert. The man who developed the technique of speed flying for the Superman films. He'd also worked on Return of the Jedi, The Alien, and Dark Crystal. His name is Bob Harmon. In Hollywood, they made special harnesses to his designs. And he developed this chair so that an actor suspended on wires could be made to turn while traveling forward.
I really started off in scaffolding back in England, and I traveled around England and Europe and Africa, lifting objects up quite often on wires, you know, specializing on that side of the field, and lifting objects up like computers and safes and bringing them where a crane couldn't reach.
Harmon rehearsed his Hollywood team so that they could continue with a smooth forward movement, while at the same time make an actor twist. It was like playing with large-scale living marionettes. Their goal was to make the movements of the astronauts look real.
It's all manual. We don't use anything mechanical at all. I mean, it's all wire rigs operated by men. I don't use anything like that because you can't feel if anything's going wrong, whereas on a, if you're doing it by hand, you can feel if something's jamming on you or you can feel if something doesn't feel right. With a motor, you don't. It just keeps pumping away and can do, you know, a lot of damage. Not necessarily to the set, but to the artist.
After weeks of rehearsal, they were ready to load the camera and begin filming. During the actual shooting, the flying was done in front of a special kind of blue screen. A bright blue light was projected from the front onto a highly reflective white surface. And then the astronauts floated into studio outer space. When the studio shots are printed with the background and sound effects added, the realism of the actor's weightlessness is totally convincing. A simple but ingenious technique creates the illusion of another world. As with all special effects, these seemingly impossible marvels are figments of imagination, made real by the manipulation of film materials, people, and props, and brought to life by human ingenuity.
Don't close your eyes. Look at the middle of Discovery. The middle, not the ends. Look at the part where it's moving the least. Don't take your eyes off it.
Hold him either.
Special effects today are a powerful mix of old techniques, new technology, and creative vision. Their potential, first defined by Méliès nearly a century ago, has reached a pinnacle. Almost anything that can be imagined can be created by special effects. The danger and the thrill seem so real. And this is how they do it. In a far-off galaxy, spaceships seem to race at the speed of light. And this is how they do it. Over a yawning chasm, only the bad guys seem to plunge to a horrible doom. And this is how they do it. Imagination, technology, hard work, and a lot of money create the magic of special effects.
Nova, the magic of special effects, will be repeated Saturday afternoon at 2. Spread the word. Now please stay on 6 for War, a commentary. Tonight, Notes on Nuclear War traces the development of the bomb through invention, development, implementation to fragile stalemate.